Hello, good afternoon everybody. My name is Beth McCushy. I'm delighted to be hosting today's webinar from SCVO with Professor Jason Leitch, our National Clinical Director, and Anna Fowley, our Chief Executive here at SCVO. We've had a fantastic response to today's event. So we've over 200 of you who've registered from voluntary organisations across the country, from very small ones down to large national ones, all across the different geographies and representing all the best parts of our sector. You don't want to hear too much from me today. You're here to hear from Jason Leitch, but I just want to run through the way that we're going to progress the conversation. So we're going to do a quick poll just to get a feeling for who's with us today on the call. Then we'll open to a conversation. Professor Leitch will give us some opening remarks, and then he and Anna will have a sort of short conversation to set the scene. Then we'll move into the questions and answers. So we know that quite a few of you have submitted questions ahead of time, and we'll take a number of those, but we'd also really like you to participate in real time with us today. So at the bottom of your screen, you'll see there's a question and answer box. If you submit your questions into there, if you see ones that you particularly like, you can upvote them, and that means we're more likely to get to them. And if you want to add comments or just sort of general chat to the other people who are on the webinar with us, you can use the chat box for that. We are recording today's event, so if you know of anybody that would like to watch it after the event, then please feel free to forward on the link and we'll provide all that information towards the end. So I think that's the broad introductions. We'll kick off with the first poll, if that's okay, just to get a feel for who's present and who's with us on the call. So our first poll should be coming up. So we just wanted to know, within your organisation, have you found ways to deliver support remotely during the lockdown? And that's just a yes or a no. So have you found new ways to deliver support remotely during the lockdown? And if we can see the results coming through for that. So yeah, 100%. And I should say my substantive post at SCVO for the last few years has been in the digital team. So that brings me a lot of joy because we've been encouraging people to do things digitally for a long time. So that's been one of the positives of the pandemic, is that it has helped a number of us to do that. So our next poll then, if we can move on to the next one. That should be popping up with us in a second. So thinking now about the roadmap and how we're moving through it, is your organisation ready to reopen your premises or services that you did have closed during lockdown? So have you been through your risk assessments? Are you ready to do the reopening? Okay, and if we can see what our results are on that. So about a 50-50, so that's interesting. So some of the questions that we get to as we move through today will maybe help us to understand what's behind some of those responses. And then the final one, if we can pop that up, is just to get a feel for what the main issues that people are concerned about today are. So that should be coming up in just a second. Yeah, so what are your biggest concerns joining us today? And you can select multiple of these. So your staff and volunteer wellbeing, how to reopen your premises safely, how to restart your face-to-face services safely, concerns about lack of funding and income, and concerns about sort of a possible second wave. So what are the biggest concerns you've got coming onto the call with us today? Okay, and if we can see, what are people saying there? Okay, so a fairly even split. So possible second wave there is the highest one, and the face-to-face services safely as the second highest, but the others are all up there and roundabout. So that's great. So hopefully we'll be able to move into and to cover quite a lot of those concerns as we move through our discussion. So we'll move over to opening remarks from Professor Leitch. He doesn't need an introduction from me. I think everybody knows the sort of the voice of the pandemic. We were having a chat ahead of time, and I was saying, you know, no pressure hosting a webinar with Scotland's best communicator. One of my colleagues said, surely that's Janie Godley, no? So I think we've got the comedy side, but also the reassurance and calm. And I was going to just say to Professor Leitch that ahead of time, as well as lots of questions, lots of people just submitted a huge thanks to you, to say thank you for helping to, you know, get us through this crisis and help the nation not feel too anxious. So a thank you from me as well. And if you'd like to give us some opening remarks, that'd be great.
Well, aren't you nice? I'm going to come back. Yesterday I did Scotland's airports and Scotland's nightclubs. It wasn't as nice as this, let me tell you. That is an excellent and lovely start. You're very gracious. And I'm very happy for harder questions, though. And I understand and completely get that it hasn't been easy for many of the individuals and the organisations represented here. I have enormous sympathy for that. And my job is to try and advise how to get out of this as safely and as quickly as we possibly can. So Before we go to those questions and maybe some sector specific stuff, let's go back a step and try and illustrate what we're in and then how we're trying to think about getting out of it. And then we'll go for a quick chat with Anna and then some questions. So the neatest way I've found of illustrating this is to describe what the WHO do. So the World Health Organization represents 194 countries around the world. And it has a thing that it can declare. And it's called a global public health emergency. And it does that by committee. So it has a thing that meets, like the United Nations, and experts and people come in and they say, we think we should declare a global public health emergency. Now, they've only done that 6 times in living memory. And the 4th one of them was Ebola. And many of you will remember the Ebola crisis. It infected globally 33,000 people. It killed 11,000 people. It's a horrible, horrible disease. It kills about a third of the people who get it. And one Scot got it. One. She was Polly McAvicky. Everybody knows her name. She was on the front page of the paper. She got it in West Africa. She was treated at the Royal Free. She survived. She became a bit of a temporary celebrity. We got no spread, no cases across our whole country. The 6th global public health emergency was rung in December of 2019. And it was a new novel coronavirus from Wuhan, China. Today, it has infected 25 million people globally, and it has killed 850,000 of them. We think that's probably a gross underestimate because we don't actually know what's happening in sub-Saharan Africa. We don't know what's happening in large swathes of China, and we don't know what's happening in large swathes of America because they're not testing anybody. So we think it's probably infected 100 million people. The world has never seen anything like this. So if life feels normal, you've misunderstood. Even now, even as we come out, you've misunderstood. My second point is to try and describe what it is we're now doing. So on the 23rd of March, we shut our country, along with pretty much the whole world. Sometime in the end of March, 180 countries went into what we've colloquially now called lockdown. Slightly different variants of it, but fundamentally, everybody shut their society. We have no treatment for this disease. We have no drugs. We have no way of preventing it. So the only treatment we had was to close everything down and put everybody in their houses. And you saw the effects of that. Now, as we reopen, let's think of that as the hammer. This analogy isn't mine. Somebody wrote it and I thought it was very clever. That's the hammer. Now we're in the dance. We've released the hammer, but now we're kind of playing whack-a-mole, if that works for you, trying to close down the outbreaks that we get, whether they're in a call center, a chicken processing plant, or Glasgow City. And you can see us desperately trying to do that. And we only have 2 tools in the kit bag for doing that. One is test and protect. Test and protect is the public health way of doing that. And that's to try and catch the positive case, get their contacts, isolate them for the incubation period of the virus, and stop the spread. That's tool number one. Tool number two is human behavior. They are the only 2 things we have. The science will help us in the end, but it doesn't help us yet. All we can do in intensive care is support the person to get better themselves with a little bit of steroid, because there's some suggestion that steroids might work. But there is no drug you can take to recover from this disease. So if you are over 80, if you're obese and you have pre-existing conditions, you're very likely to die of it. If you're 14 and fit, you're very unlikely to die of it. In fact, you'll be lucky to even know you had it. But there's enormous variation in that description. So now you can see us with the human behavior and the test and protect thing, trying desperately to allow society just to edge back to normal. And we could go into every sector in the country. Every time I open a new bit of the onion, another piece of society reveals itself to me that I didn't know existed. This week I was actually asked, can we open trampolining clubs? Now, if you told me when I was a surgeon doing facial surgery for a living that one day I would be asked and make the decision whether we could open trampolining clubs, I'd have thought you were completely nuts. So from trampolining clubs to the oil and gas sector, to the whole of your sector and its breadth, from massive Macmillan cancer to a small homeless charity in Alloa that might be cooking meals for three families. I understand the difficulty in that. So I hope we can get you on the road to what that recovery might look like and reopening might look like, bearing in mind that many of you never shut at all. I mean, many of you stayed open and provided essential services that kept the wheels of the country moving, and I'm enormously grateful for you doing that. So that's my final thing before I just open up, and that's to thank each of you, both for your leadership, your organization's leadership, the fact that some of you just knocked doors of some vulnerable individuals, some of you cooked 4,000 meals, some of you ran cancer care, and everything in between. And I'm hugely grateful for everything you did for young people, for older people, and everything in between. So that's my introduction, Anna. I'm happy to take it wherever you wish it to go.
Thanks very much. And it is great. I just add best thanks to you for coming along to participate in this. And you can see, we know from the people that have signed up from this webinar exactly what you said there, that we've got such a breadth of different responsibilities across the sector and such a breadth of contribution to make. And that's also reflected in the breadth of the impact. So a lot of what we've heard so far publicly has been about the contribution that the sector has made, which has been fantastic. But we also need to focus on ourselves as organisations to survive this. And I think that's, I'm hoping that's a lot of what we can get into today, because obviously we are dependent as a society in Scotland on not just that immediate crisis response, but also having the sector there for recovery and for renewal. So that kind of how we deal with the public health impact as well as with the economic impact, which obviously is very important for yeah. many organisations, but not the focus really for today. So I suppose my reflections would be that the different approaches, as you, I mean, the trampoline one's a really good example. There'll be lots of that going on in the voluntary sector, but you, there might also be people sort of providing an art gallery, for example, or running visitor attractions in the tourism industry. And that's something that I'm really interested in, because you talked about guidance. We discussed guidance just before we went on air. And actually the sector is present in a lot of the guidance for many sectors. So whether it's tourism, whether it's health and social care, whether it's employability, all those different sectors are reflected in the voluntary sector as a whole. So I don't envy the challenge of this webinar, because the questions could come from absolutely anywhere, but that's why I love working on it. I think, Beth, it would be useful to open up the questions, because I'm really conscious that we've got so many questions. This has been our most signed up for webinar so far in all that we've done, and I'm anxious to make sure that everyone who's online can get their questions in. I'm noticing that some people are putting questions in the chat. If you could put questions into the question and answer, that makes it much easier to keep track of. Thank you.
Brilliant. That's great. Thanks, Anna. So we'll get straight into the questions then. So the first one is actually from Alex, who many of you will know across the sector, who is our events manager at SCVO. But his question is of relevance, I think, to many organisations. So he was asking, he says, "It's been great organising online webinars and events from the comfort of my bedroom for the past few months. But when do you think events, conferences and exhibitions can start up again? And are there any lessons we can learn from the first pilot rugby test match with supporters last week to help us in planning future events?"
There are. I can't give you an exact date and time. We've had to learn a new word in lockdown, a number of new words. One of them is indicative. And we have some indicative dates still in the route map. 14th September is the next indicative date for some more return of major events, return of crowds, return to stadia even. We are anxious about that, and that date may not remain. The next three-week compulsory review is a week on Thursday for Cabinet, a week on Tuesday to get advice from us over next weekend. It seems relentless. Those three-week reviews pass so fast. It feels like an hour and a half since we were doing the last one. In principle, what we're suggesting is that each type of event should run some pilots. So whether that's a conference event or a music event or an outdoor movie, or as you saw, the first stadium event for sport on Friday night with a 65,000 seater stadium with 750 people in it, all in one stand, distanced, most who lived locally so that we wouldn't burden public transport, and most people filled in a medical questionnaire before they came so we avoided the vulnerable, etc., etc. You can see how that might work. If you think of the opening of any sector in line with those two treatments that I discussed, so your sector has to open to help test and protect and to help human behaviour. So the things you do to help test and protect are contact lists, understand the layout of your environment. So if test and protect phone you and say, where was Frank sitting? You should be able to answer that, because you want to know if Frank was beside Mary or beside John, because it might be quite important if Frank becomes positive. Frank can't quite remember where he was. And where are your toilets? Where is your coffee? Where is your front door? What was your one-way system like? So that's how you can open, whether you're a conference or a Alcoholics Anonymous group. That's the test and protect bit. And the second bit is you should do your best to help the human behavior. So force the human behavior to be helpful. So hand sanitizer at every door. Somebody with hand sanitizer at the front door, for example, like in the schools. Or a one-way system. So if we've got a start time of 3 o'clock, we're going to make everybody come in sequence at 5 to 3, whatever. And spaced out seating so that everybody is forced to physically distance. So you could free face coverings if that's necessary for your thing. So you can think about opening in terms of how you can help the human behavior element and how you can help the test and protect system if they have to call you because there's a positive case.
Great, fantastic. Thank you very much. Hopefully that helps, Alex. I know that we're going to be probably doing remote events for the foreseeable, but it's good to start to think through, you know, when we do start to reopen more face-to-face things, how we go about that. So there's a few questions that came in advance, and then I'll move to the ones in the Q&A, but we had quite a number here, and I've just picked out two of them from people who run sort of support groups. So this one was from Paul Stevenson at the Bethany Christian Trust, saying, we run support groups for individuals indoors who have a history of homelessness but are no longer homeless. Are the guidelines that would permit such groups from meeting that consist of more than 3 households and more than 8 people? And then a similar one from Anita from Dundee Volunteer Voluntary Action. And she was saying, are local community groups actually allowed to restart under the current guidelines? And if so, do we need to stick to the 3 households indoors, 5 households outdoors rules?
They are allowed to restart, and they do not have to stick to the household guidance, but there is a lot of guidance. So you probably don't want to put the advert out tonight for starting tomorrow, because there's quite a lot of work to do if you haven't thought about it too much yet. So the guidance is, you won't be surprised by any of it, but it is extensive. The closest broad guidance is probably the community and learning development guidance. It's pretty dense. It's quite a lot of it, but it is worth the work. And it includes all those things in mitigation, the one-way systems, the hand sanitizer, the face coverings, all those things we've just talked about, the cleaning regimes, all of those types of things. And one of the challenges in government is that if we wrote individual guidance for every single scenario, honestly, there must be thousands. I mean, I think we've got 80 pieces of individual sector guidance already. It's oil and gas and renewables and essential retail, non-essential retail, health. So you get the idea. So if you took it, probably the closest to most of these sectors is community learning development. If you take that one, and you're going to have to use your brain, though, to adapt it. If you're young Scott, you're going to adapt that a little bit differently from if you're Macmillan Cancer. We kind of trust you to be able to do that. But the basics will be the same. The basics will be, how are we going to keep people distant? How are we going to protect particularly the vulnerable? If you're in Glasgow City just now, and you're in you were in the shielded group, we're suggesting you should be extra vigilant. So that suggests to me you probably wouldn't go anywhere if it wasn't essential. And your definition of essential will be up to you, not up to me. But we should use a hybrid version of online and one-to-one. Lots of people, if there's a homeless charity that needs to feed the homeless, that shouldn't have shut ever. So that should have been open the whole time. Never mind reopening now. And as we begin to think about what that route map looks like for young people who might need mental health counselling, or so that can begin to open now if you can do it safely. And that's 2 meter distant, that's face coverings in crowded areas, it's cleaning the surfaces, it's having breaks between groups. So if you've got, let's say you've got a group of additional support needs kids at 1 o'clock, and you've got a musical instrument class at 4 o'clock. I'm probably looking at a gap between them to make sure the cleaning is done properly, to make sure that everybody has cleared the area before we start our new thing. Keeping in bubbles as well. So as far as possible, keep the groups together. Now that, depending on your sector, isn't always possible. Sport is our best example of that. So if you are in the first team at Rangers, you are in the bubble of the first team at Rangers. You are not meant to be meeting the reserves or the team from Celtic or other. You're trying to keep within that one group, to keep your risk as low as you can go. And if there's a positive in there, we know what the bubble is. So if you're running a community-based counselling service, then try and keep the counsellor with one set of individuals rather than 400 sets of individuals.
Fantastic. That's great. Thank you very much. I'm going to move over to the question answers that are coming in real time just now. So the one that's at the top of the list is from Julie Hutchison, and she's asking, thinking of hard to reach communities where we need to work differently to ensure that public health messages are heard, which communities are you worried are not being reached, and how could our sector help?
Yeah, that's what a terrific question. The chicken process, I know more about chicken processing than any man should, incidentally. And than I ever wanted to know. But the chicken processing plant is a little microcosm of the challenge of this. 1,100 employees in the only remaining chicken processing plant in Scotland that kills 1 million chickens a week, 19 languages, 3 principal languages, Polish, Bulgarian, and Slovakian, and houses of multiple occupancy, not always the most reliable houses of multiple occupancy, and non-translated facts and letters of advice and all of the things you would expect. Although facts has now been translated into 37 languages and is available online, but there's also an accessibility problem, a health literacy challenge, all those things all rolled into one. I am worried about that. I was worried about it when we had a small outbreak in England, principally in the temporary farm workers that we get for soft fruits in the north of England and in Perthshire and Tayside. We managed to avoid it, but it was ropey for a little while, and we did quite a lot of work with the community organisations who went in and helped us, and the same was true in Cooper Angus. When the history is written of this pandemic, the NHS Tayside and local authority responses to the Cooper Angus outbreak were astonishing. They visited, Perth and Kinross visited 250 houses in a day to deliver food parcels, to check up on everybody, to make sure everybody understood the rules. And they eventually got to every single household of those 1,100 staff to make sure they were supported, they understood the rules and the guidance. And there was no community transmission of that virus beyond the 180 people who caught it, who were employees of the factory. I didn't think that was possible. When I first heard the Cooper Angus story, I was scared. So it just illustrates the nature of how you have to get to every element of community, whether sometimes it's demographic, sometimes it's geographic. It might be offshore workers. We've had to do communication with offshore people who are in helicopters, and we've had to go to those who don't speak English as their first language. I've also done some work with the traveling community, who are a particular challenge for this virus because of the nature of how they live. And that's just fact. You can rage against it if you like, it doesn't help you. So you've got to be able to engage in that. And actually the leaders of those communities are hugely helpful, and they understand the nature of, once you explain the disease, how the disease works, they can come up with solutions to help protect their own communities rather than me trying to guess.
Great, and I don't know, Anna, is there anything you maybe want to come in on that as well, just around, you know, the role of our sector and you know, we are often in touch with and reaching out to people in the community who are maybe not reached by mass messages in the same way that the rest of the population might be?
Yeah, I think that lots of particularly local charities are and voluntary sector organisations are really good bridges into harder to reach, for want of a better phrase, communities. And I think for me, as always, grassroots football springs to mind. There's a lot of activity happens around work that's going on in organisations like Big Hearts, for example, where you can reach people that you wouldn't reach through other mechanisms, like Syrian refugees, for example, would be one example. So I do think that community organisations are very good bridges to reach people.
One of the challenges with schools being closed, of course, is that one of the principal community routes to those areas has been closed to us. Not completely, that's unfair. Schools have been open. So my wife teaches English as an additional language in North Lanarkshire. And those, in the main, quite vulnerable families and kids have not only had no English teaching, but they've also not had the pastoral support that Lynn and others bring within that school setting. One of the reasons we were so desperate to get schools back was not just the education elements, but the public health elements, that schools are so much more important than just the learning. They are a public health intervention, and I hated them being closed.
Yeah, absolutely. I've got a good friend who's a teacher who's staying away from everywhere so that she can make sure she gets to school every day, because she thinks it's great. An important thing she can do. So there's one here that quite a lot of people asked ahead of time. I'm just going to read out. So this was from Ken Newstead, who actually is from Public Health Scotland. So her ask was about, can face-to-face cooking classes be held either indoor kitchens or in outdoor facilities? And how many households can take part, and can they share food?
So there's a lot in there. So the basic answer is yes, if the guidance is met. So I would be more comfortable outdoors than indoors. Cooking is dodgy because the heat, the humidity, the virus. Let's think about what the virus likes. Think of a nightclub. I know some of you will have to go back further than others, but nightclubs are pretty much petri dishes for this virus. If you've got kids, think of soft play. That's the same kind of environment. No ventilation, lots of central heating, lots of people, no distancing, maybe some booze to lubricate the social distancing. It's a disaster. I'm not suggesting these cooking classes would be quite like that, but some of the elements that make nightclubs risky are also there. So you've got to be very strict with distancing, very strict with hand hygiene and surface hygiene. You shouldn't share plates of food, and you shouldn't share utensils. Right at the beginning, we were saying, don't even go to the same place to eat. We've moved on from that a little bit. So you don't have to take your own food to your mum's. You can eat your mum's food, but it'd be better if that was a separate batch of food than the one, so you're not all dipping into the same thing. It's just the virus likes surfaces. So just think of it as if it were fluorescent. If the virus is on that spoon, and you don't want to give it to your mum because you don't know you've got it. So you need to think in those terms and keep the numbers to a minimum. But that doesn't mean in a regulated environment where you follow the guidance, you can't have more people than you would in an unregulated environment like your own home. So be cautious, but you can gradually think about those things coming back.
Fantastic. That's great. Thank you. So another one that's come through in the question and answer live just now. Somebody's asking, can you clarify the rules around the amount of households that can be indoors? And this is specifically because they're hoping to hold their AGM in October. Could it be held indoors if they had a large enough hall with social distancing? And many members are online, are older, so holding it online would exclude a lot of people.
Yeah, that's tricky. I'm not sure that's that reaches the threshold for being required or for serving a vulnerable community, or it just doesn't feel quite to reach the bar where you would have to do it. It feels a bit non-essential. I don't like the essential versus non-essential division, because essential retail versus non-essential retail makes no sense if you own the business and you employ four teenagers. It's essential for them. So I don't particularly like it. But you should be cautious about think if there was a positive case. If there was a positive case in that environment, then would you be able to justify the fact that you brought that together? If you can, then that's okay. The rules for strict households is 3 households, 8 people indoors, 5 households, 15 people outdoors. But there are exceptions to that, like youth work, like counselling services, like so it's not an exact science. So you can't look up your particular meeting and say, oh, look, I'm allowed, I'm not allowed. You've got to use some element of common sense. But business meetings, I'm not sure I'm going to do that. For instance, in my church, I'm not sure I'm going to be having a business meeting one-to-one for some time, but the worship services will start. So there's a nuanced difference there, and you've got to use your judgment. I know you'd rather we made binary choices, but you're going to have to make some judgments.
Yeah, and that's the harder thing, isn't it, about sort of when it's not a complete lockdown, we've all got to
if you want to go back to that, and I was much more comfortable with in April than I am now. It was much easier for me. The radio shows were much more straightforward when I just told everybody to stay at home.
Yeah, I'm sure. Okay, so the next one. So this is a big issue that's come into our information service a lot, and we've been talking to SCDC about as well. And we've kind of touched on it already, Jason, but just to give it a bit more airtime, the whole issue around shared use community centres, village halls, premises that maybe are owned or run by one organisation but used by multiple organisations. We had loads of questions about this. So one that came in from Julie Fox from Annex Communities, just saying, you know, what's advice for reopening community centres, often with multiple user groups, frequently changing room layouts, use during the course of the day, you know, one set of toilets, one shared kitchen, all of the kind of the issues that come up with that.
So I think probably the best way to think about this is risk assessments. That's pretty dull, isn't it? I don't like starting an answer with, let's do a risk assessment. You've got to risk assess two things. You've got to risk assess the premises and the people. So, and you should be pretty strict with yourself for the very reason that if you get a positive case, you're going to be on the front page of the paper. So let's think about doing that as safely as we can within the guidance. And you're going to have gaps between events. You're going to have to be able to clean it. If you can't clean it, you shouldn't have it there. If you can't have gaps between events, you shouldn't have them there. So it's relatively strict, but that doesn't mean, back to my church in Airdrie, we've run a food bank the whole way through lockdown. We've never shut, but we haven't run the mother and toddlers group because we thought that was not required. And now we're beginning to think about what will it mean for a worship service? What would it mean for the youth group to come back? We're going to do that twice a month. We're not going to do it every week. We're going to gradually move it back. We're going to make them wear face coverings. We're going to make them, I mean, imagine coming to the National Clinical Directors Church. Can you think of anything worse? So they're going to be mitigated within an inch of their lives. They're probably going to wish they'd stayed at home. But the nature of that means we're going to clean after they've gone. We're going to give it time before the next thing arrives. But the food bank has happened every Friday since it just hasn't stopped. We didn't stop it during lockdown. So you need to put yourself on that barrier somewhere, on that gradient somewhere where you think your service sits. Make a judgment about how you can keep it safe, and then think about what it then relates to, both the premises, and then let's also, since we're on risk assessments, think about the risk assessments of the people. Also very important, and also not an exact science, but there is online on the government website an individual risk assessment that you can do for people, and that gives you, it's not like a marker at 10, but it gives you an idea of the risk of the individual, both you and your clients. And it's based on ethnicity, weight, disease, age, pre-existing conditions, all the things you would expect it to be. The principal risks for this disease are age and weight. Pre-existing conditions are next, and ethnicity is in there, but ethnicity is not the biological problem, it's a racism problem. So BAME people are at risk of this disease because of racism, not because their biology makes them more at risk of this disease. So that's about access to services, it's about living conditions, it's about all the other things that we know racism causes in the Western world. But the principal things you can do something about are to try and work out what those risk assessments are for the individuals you're seeing. So if I were running an under 12s football club from a community centre, I'm not overly worried about that. I'm thinking they can come in their clothes, ready to play. They don't need to go indoors at all, except maybe to the loo. They're going to play on the outdoor pitch, and then they're all going to go back in their cars with their parents, and we're all good. Pretty much no risk. If I'm running an elderly care, disabled access something, play group or something. Now I'm more worried. So I'm going to do individual risk assessments of all of those individuals. I'm going to keep the numbers to a minimum. I'm going to be very strict about distancing. I'm going to try and keep a bubble so I know that those six people are coming and the person in charge is going to be John, and the six that come next week, Jean's going to be in charge of them because it's a different six. So you're going to have to start to think about what that looks like depending on the risk assessment of the individuals in question.
Yeah. And so the onus there would be on both the organisations that are hiring the hall, so your girl guides or your whoever else, but also on the organisations that are running the hall. So
I think so, and I don't want to make it sound as though I'm crippling it. I don't want it to be so difficult that everybody runs away and thinks we're not going to do anything. We want society to open, but we're at the edge of what we can safely open. So if you open, it's got to be safe. Yeah. Because the last thing you want is that your youth group has four positive cases and suddenly, never mind on the front page of the paper, which would be bad enough, some of them might be sick. And you're going to have to deal with the aftermath of what that would mean.
Yeah. And just a final one on this theme, just to check about the role of local health protection and environmental health teams. And if people do need support with doing these risk assessments, can they call on that local support?
They can. I have to warn you that they're a bit thinly spread. So probably organisationally rather than individually. So locally, they will of course try and help you. And environmental health officers have been huge across the country, particularly in Aberdeen City. That outbreak, which led to 450 positives from a single, slightly raucous weekend in the centre of Aberdeen. Environmental health have visited 180 premises. They've checked the mitigation. So they've been enormously valuable to us and they're really good at it. Now they will have online generic advice, and they will try and give you individual advice, as will the health protection teams and your local health boards. But just to warn you, that these people are working pretty hard. So better if, what kind of example could I give? Better if Macmillan Cancer got the advice once, rather than all the Macmillan Cancer groups get the advice, or Young Scot went for the advice, or YouthLink went for the advice, rather than all the youth groups. And then YouthLink can then maybe play the part of holding that together. And SCVO could hold some of that responsibility around what that might look like. But individual local boards and health protection teams will help you as much as they possibly can.
Great. And I think, is it worth saying there, Anna, we've been producing the Coronavirus Information Hub and also working quite closely with the SCDC. We've got the Supporting Community Safety pages that we've been talking to them about, and they're planning to update as well. So I think certainly for us, a takeaway from all of these questions is looking at that support for organisations and what is our role or their role or other national bodies' roles, as well as the local support from the TSIs. Okay, moving on to another one that we've had through in the Q&A. So this is from Keith Brotherston. So it's been suggested that buildings should use a free flow of air and where possible aircon to enable them to reopen. What happens if buildings don't have aircon and can't put them in? How do buildings get around this?
Actually, this virus would rather free flowing air from outside rather than air conditioning, actually. So open windows. What we don't want is dungeons and basements. They are the worst thing. So stagnant air is what this virus likes. Anything where the air isn't moving. That's why outdoors is so much better than indoors, because the virus hangs about in the indoors, doesn't settle on surfaces quite as quickly, and needs time to drop and then be cleaned away. So air conditioning is a bit dodgy. We're not quite sure about how the virus reacts to air conditioning. There's some suggestions in China that air conditioning just circulates the virus and keeps it up in the air, which we don't like, of course. We want it, if it's there, we want it to settle and be cleaned away, because it doesn't survive that. So the best thing, unfortunately, in a Scottish summer is to get the windows open and let the air flow. And you'll have seen in some of our public transport, they've been opening all the windows to try and get the air flowing. That's what we want. We want air to circulate rather than it to be stagnant. And air conditioning, it isn't entirely reliable in that sense. So if you've got a choice of halls, do the one that's got the fresh air in it and you can open the door.
So the person that asked that question is one of our Terence, one of the colleagues that works with us in our own building in Mansfield Square, which is a crypt of a church.
There we are.
It's a listed building. You can't open the windows. So, yeah.
So you're thinking that's not coming back anytime soon?
Not coming back anytime.
If there's an alternative location for that, I'm looking for it.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay, great, thanks. So changing tack slightly, so these have come in from Nicola Mitchell. We had quite a lot of questions in advance from Nicola and from the Dundee Pensioners Forum. So considering the serious effects of loneliness and isolation in older people, both mental and physical health, caused by lockdown restrictions, what will Scottish Government put in place to support and enable older people's groups to restart activities and reach out to their communities? And can you give us an indication of when it will happen?
So I'm not sure I know the answer to that question, because what will the government put in place? We will endeavour to give the best guidance we can within the nature of the pandemic we've got to be able to get things moving as fast and as easily as we can. But we've got to do that within a framework that allows it to happen gradually and safely. So You've seen what we've tried to do in care homes, and it breaks my heart that we've had to do visiting in such a gradual way, with outdoors, with such distancing. It's just horrible. And last night, suggesting that Glasgow City and East Renfrewshire and Western Bartonshire would have to go back again to no indoor visiting, it's terrible. And that vulnerable older age group have really suffered during this, but they're also the most vulnerable to the disease. So I think the sector has to come forward with what it thinks is safe to do, how it wants to do that. And you've heard the basics of what that looks like: small groups, outdoors rather than indoors if you can do it, ventilated, hand sanitizer, but you should be able to do that as safely as you possibly can.
Okay, great, thank you. Right, another one from the Q&A, which has just disappeared. Here we are. Right, so this is from Emma Oram, and she's saying, now we perhaps see the networks of care in our communities which have always been there. How could health and social care partnerships work with volunteers, individuals and neighbourhoods to learn what they know and co-create stronger relationships, so doing with rather than doing to, and ensure both physical and mental health and well-being?
It's a crucial question. The nature of, so pandemics are never good. In fact, they're horrific, and we shouldn't ever celebrate them. But a couple of things have come from this one, which I think we will keep. One is digital, and the nature of digital appointments and digital connection for many of our communities that wouldn't have done that before. The postman in Golspie has now had his gastroenterology appointment done by the NHS near me, because I was there listening to him, and he was loving it. He was still on his postman's round. And he lit up a cigarette in his postie cab, and we had to shout at him to put his cigarette out. And he said, I forgot I was at the doctor. So the nature of some of the digital innovation is terrific. The other thing I think we should hold on to is exactly your questioner's point, that we, particularly this crowd, has always known that community spirit and community engagement was there. What have we done? Catalyzed it? Lit a fire under it? Something has changed. I mean, my neighbours have sent me their phone numbers for the first time ever, left little cards on everybody's step, and all of those things. Kids have got engaged with it, the rainbows, the clap. And there needs to be some way of harnessing some of that. And the third sector and voluntary sector seem to me to be in a very good place to try and do that. That still needs real organization behind it to grasp it. So if we're going to cook meals for the vulnerable, somebody needs to organize that, and somebody needs to pay for that, and somebody, so we need to think in a professional way about what that looks like. But I hope we don't lose some of that community spirit. The second part of the question is about design, which I'm passionate that we use users, patients and families in the health system, clients in social work, whatever language you want to use, to redesign that remobilization. We have paused a lot of care and services, so why wouldn't you take the advantage to ask those who use those services how to do them? The story that comes to me is another NHS Near Me story. If you don't, NHS Near Me is our video consultation process that's gone from 300 a week to 30,000 a week in 3 months. And we did some user-centered design of it. Now, so we designed it first because we thought we knew best. And then we asked some patients and families what they would like from a video consultation system. And to our great surprise, the single biggest answer was, we'd like to speak to a receptionist. And we thought, we thought you hated receptionists. They're grumpy and horrible. But no, the patients and families wanted to speak to a real human being before they were put through to the doctor or the nurse, so they would know they were going to have to wait, and they were, how it was going to work, and who was going to talk to them. And you're now going to go through to Jean because she's your doctor, she's your gastroenterologist or whatever. So that's what we did. So now if you phone NHS near me or you press the app, you get to speak to a live grumpy receptionist who puts you in the virtual waiting room and tells you exactly what's going to happen. And people have absolutely loved it. It's just a little illustration of how the professionals would have avoided that step entirely. We thought people would love to be away from that. Actually, people love it. And they get to ask questions they maybe wouldn't ask when they're in the doctor's surgery or they're in with a nurse. So if we don't use people to design people's services, we've kind of missed the point a little bit.
There we are. Receptionists of the world unite, eh? So that's
indeed. And they're not all grumpy, I'm being...
Those of us that have sort of service designy type bits of our job will be hearing music to our ears there. Anna, I don't know if there's anything you'd like to add there on the, you know, the sort of building back stronger role of the sector sort of element of the question.
Well, actually, one of the things I wanted to add was something that's come up in the chat and was going through my mind, which is about the importance of older people as volunteers in the sector, across the sector. So while we often look at older people in the context of services they receive, actually they disproportionately contribute in our sector in a volunteering capacity. So there's something about being really careful not to kind of dampen that enthusiasm and take away that amazing contribution to people's self-esteem and their confidence and their feeling of purpose in life, but in a way that they can do that safely. So that's something that I think we're always mindful of and trying to think about, where you have to be mindful of people's safety, but actually there's also something about them feeling purposeful and being allowed to feel purposeful.
Absolutely.
Somebody's asked, I should probably cover it in case you don't get it. Somebody's asked about maximum numbers. There isn't really a maximum number. I would just ask you to be very careful. And the distancing is not just about the distancing between the individuals in the room. You've got to think about bathrooms. You've got to think about corridors. You've got to think about doors in and out. So be conservative would be my fundamental advice. And start slowly. So don't put an advert out for 100 people to come tomorrow to the men's tool club. Go slowly and just check your systems before you start to then think about what would this mean for a dozen, what would this mean for 20?
Yep, great. There's a couple that have come in that are about sort of testing and staff, and there were a few that came in ahead of time as well. So this is from Lorraine Jarvie. She's saying, is it worth staff getting a test to give some comfort to their colleagues or clients? And then ahead of time, people had also asked if somebody does test positive, do you shut down the organisation for 14 days? How do you kind of deal with that?
Yep. So the first one, I wish it were true. I just so wish the test did what that suggests. The best example is travel from Greece or France. Greece today, the test is a swab up your nose and down your throat. It's a cotton bud, and it looks for live virus or remnants of virus. It has to find it, or it tests you negative. If it doesn't actually find virus, you get a negative test. If it finds virus, it might be live virus that could spread to somebody else. It might be 6 weeks since you had the virus, and it's DNA, genetic material, from the virus you had. The test is a bit rubbish. Now, that doesn't play to the newspaper headlines to test the population, but the test is, frankly, a bit rubbish. So we've got to use the test for what it's good for, and we shouldn't use it for what it's not good for. It doesn't make you safe. And I so wish it did, because this job would be so much easier if it did. Because if you catch the virus today and I swab you today, I won't find any virus. But you'll incubate it, so it'll be in your bloodstream, but you won't shed it. So you won't have it in your saliva or up your nose for somewhere between 5 to 14 days. probably 5 to 7 days, but some people incubate it for 10 to 14 days. No virus, but you're infective for the 2 days before you shed it, before you get symptoms rather. So you start to shed it before you get symptoms. So get the virus today, incubate until Sunday, still no symptoms. I go for my tea on Sunday night. I go to my dance class on Monday morning. I'm shedding the virus. Nobody knows. I don't know. You don't know. And then I suddenly develop symptoms on the Tuesday. And now we're in trouble. So now the contact, now I get my positive test because it's found virus. Test and Protect phone me. And this goes to the second part of your question, Beth. So Test and Protect will then phone me on the Tuesday and say, we're very sorry. You've got a positive test for coronavirus. Can you please tell us where you've been and who you were with for the last 48 hours before your symptoms? So we go from the first symptom backwards 2 days. So that takes me to Sunday and Monday. And we now go through like a detective how I behaved. So which room was I in? Who was I with? Was I on public transport? Who did I have my tea with? Were my kids there? Did I go see my granny? Was I at the Alcoholics Anonymous class? When I was there, where was I sitting? The guy who came in who was new, who didn't understand the distancing, did you have coffee with him? How was the coffee laid out? Were there spoons? Did you share the spoons? So proper detective work. Anybody who's contact traced in that environment or anybody who we doubt is then phoned separately by Test and Protect and they are isolated. We would only shut down the whole thing if we thought the risk assessment we did required it. So we went to the factory, the Cooper Angus factory. We had 40 positive cases and we thought, okay, this factory needs to close. Alpha Solway and Dumfries and Galloway, one positive case, we went to visit, we kept the factory open. So there's a judgment in there about the mitigation, the number of positives, the stories from the individuals about whether your church, your mosque, your youth group would have to all isolate, not isolate, and it's a judgment. The best way to not be isolated or shut down is to follow the guidance. It's not that complicated. We won't shut you down if you get a single positive who hasn't touched anything, hasn't been within 2 meters of anybody else, used the one-way system and cleaned the bathroom after they used it. Then there's no reason to shut you down. If those things aren't true, then we'll shut you down.
Great. Thanks. I'm very conscious of time. I think we've probably got time for one more question. So I'll ask the last one and then hopefully final comments from both Anna and Jason before we go. So Linda Sterry had asked, she was saying many of us lead charities that have continued to work throughout the pandemic and we're wrestling with the dilemma of what are essential offices and what aren't. We're trying to balance the safety and wellbeing of our staff with the pressing needs of our service users. So can you elaborate a wee bit on that?
Yeah, what a lovely one to finish with. Much of that is judgment. So right on the 23rd of March, essential was milk, bread and electricity and health and care systems. I mean, there wasn't much in the essential box. We have moved. So essentially, we've decided that you can open youth groups. We've decided that kids can play sport again. We've decided that bingo halls can open, for heaven's sake. So we've moved the definition of essential along a gradient. And I can't tell you if your specific thing that you've committed your life to or you've built your charity about is completely essential. You're going to have to do some of that thinking and common sense yourself. The non-essential offices thing is slightly different. Essential services, non-essential services, I think has got much broader. We're still not keen for large numbers of people to be back at work in a traditional sense. And that's not just about the office buildings, it's about public transportation. It's about lunch breaks. It's about just everybody coming back to the train and the buses because we know that will create bridges for the virus to spread along. So you should be cautious about opening up offices. So the civil service has, we have one civil service building open in the whole country and it's St Andrew's House and it's where we do the First Minister's briefings from and it's about 10 of us in the building. So we haven't put back the civil service in any meaningful way at all. And those of you who know Dot Hartley, who's my private secretary, is every day asking me if she can get back. And for 5 months I've been telling her no, she's hating it. So it's really hard for people, particularly sociable people who have lived like that their whole lives, but you shouldn't be bringing back non-essential office workers until we decide it's safer than it is now.
Thanks. Fantastic. Thank you. So I think that's us getting towards the end of time. Anna, I don't know if there's some final remarks you'd like to make before we go to the final closing.
I just think the questions have reflected exactly what I thought, that there's just so many, and we have millions more. So we have so many coming in there that we might need to do something about following up afterwards, and some really useful links as well. Thank you to people who put links into the chat bar, so we'll work out how to share that as well as a follow-up to this event, because this could have probably gone on for about 3 hours if we all had the time. There's just so many things. I think the thing about uncertainty, and we're all looking for certainty, but you can't have it. So at the moment, that element of professional judgment, of just human judgment that Jason's talked about, is something that we all have to try and be more confident in, I think, and think about our own roles and how we do that within our own organisations or with our stakeholders. So I suppose that's something I'm taking away, is the uncertainty is natural and it's right, but we need to see what we can do to bring some sort of assurance to people wherever we can.
Great, fantastic. Thank you so much. So it just remains for me then to say an enormous thank you to Professor Leitch for joining us today, for all of your thoughtful answers and all of the wisdom that was there. Apologies to those of you whose questions we didn't manage to get to. As Anna said, we're really keen to hear what the issues are. So please get in touch with us. You can email the events inbox or get in touch with SCVO over our social media. We'll do what we can to try and improve the information on our information hub, and to try and make sure that that's got as many good links to good guidance as we can, whether that's Scottish Government or guidance that's been produced by the sector and for the sector. So please do that. For those of you that are interested in the kind of village halls, community centre, shared use spaces, we do have another webinar coming up specifically on that topic on the 15th of September. You can book onto that on our website, so please do go ahead and do that if you want to sort of follow up on some of those questions and queries. For those of you that are running amazing, fantastic services and organisations, which I'm sure are everybody here, please do get involved in our Never More Needed campaign. We're trying to highlight the positive impact of our sector throughout the pandemic and the work that we've got ahead of us. So again, find out on our website or on our social media more about that if you haven't heard of it. So thank you again, Jason and Anna, for all of the time and the thoughtfulness today. We will, I'm sure, follow this up in a number of different ways. And thank you all for coming along. It's been an absolute delight. So thank you very much.
Thanks, everybody.